Hi everyone, good evening. I'm Jayne with Rockin' Worms. Nice to have you join me tonight. I was thinking about the cocoon bins that I did a video on just a few days ago, the progress of the cocoon bins, and I'll link that in the description if you haven't had a chance to watch it yet. But I was thinking that, you know, what I want to do with these worm bins is basically prepare them for their first sifting, all right, to be able to move the worms into fresh bedding and collect the castings that are in their current bin. So I'm going to start working on this while I talk to you. So I have a moisture barrier. I did dry these bins down also using the cardboard thin method over the last several days. You know what, I'll link that down in the description as well, because that method is working out super great. So I did dry down the bin. I dried it down enough to where I wanted it to be, where it was moist, but not as moist as it had been coming out of the breeder bin situation. And you can see, look at this beautiful carpet that is just a result of the worm movement action through the substrate. It makes the top just get this beautiful carpet or pool table effect. Anyways, I just think it's pretty. Oh, hey, look at over here. Here are some cocoons that don't look like they've hatched yet. A whole bunch. Somehow they've come up to the surface. That's really interesting. Look at a whole bunch. Is that one? Oh, I thought maybe that one was starting to hatch. Anyways, as you can see, that although this bin is approximately 2 months old, I started it on February 13th or the 16th, that weekend, I still have cocoons that need to hatch. And that's fine. Cocoons will hatch when they're good and ready to hatch. But let's dig in, as I did a couple days ago on that other video, on the progress video. And you can see there are lots of worms in here that have already hatched. And I'm just going to aerate this again, even though I did it just a few days ago, because I can. And it gives me a chance to admire my worms. I was looking to see. You can see some of these worms are getting good sized. These worms would have been cocoons that were laid like right in the beginning of the 21-day cycle and then hatched pretty, you know, pretty much after their couple weeks of incubation. I don't know what you want to call it, but they hatched. So these guys have been growing as hatched worms for probably just shy of 2 months. So they're getting a nice size. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is use an idea I had. So I was thinking about how can I make the first sifting of these worms out of this beautiful substrate a little bit easier for me. So I decide, well, one way to do that is to make the worms as big as possible in the time frame between, you know, you pick up a couple, oops, they're falling off my glove here. Make these worms as big as possible so more worms stay in the sifter and less worms fall through into the castings, which would then mean I would have to bait them out, or at least I have the option to bait them out. So how do I make the worms fatter in the next, you know, 3 to 4 weeks I have before I want to do my first sift out of this bin? Well, the answer is, I think, worm chow. So worm chow is a blend of dry ingredients. What I'm doing here is I'm just making a little trough area toward the bottom, not all the way down to the bottom, toward the bottom of the bin, because this worm food I want to bury so I don't entice any more mites into my bin than I already have. Mites in a bin are not a problem unless they just kind of take over. In fact, they can perform a very vital function to your worm bin, in addition to their ability to, you know, eat dead worms. So you don't have, you know, dead worms hanging around. They will consume the dead worms. But they also provide another important function to your worm bin when they die. And that's going to be the subject of a video I'm going to make this weekend and release. So I'm planning on releasing it on Sunday. So you might want to check back for that. Anyways, so now that I have got this little area here, I'm going to put in this paper towel just kind of as a marker. It's looks like that because I bought some raspberries today. And I, you know, rinsed them and dry them because I'm freezing them. But anyways, now I'm putting in the worm chow. And as I started to say before, the worm chow is a mix of dry grains, wheat flour, oats, bird seed. I also put in layer pellets. I put in herbs if I have some. I have a lot of cilantro right now growing in my garden. So I pick and dry that. If I have leaves from edible plants, I have some cranberry hibiscus. I pick those leaves, dry them, crush them up, put them in my worm chow. I don't think I have any in here on this batch, but I do put those in as well. But anyway, so what I'm going to do is I put in the worm chow, you know, a decent amount, but nothing crazy. There's a lot of worms in here, about, I would guess around 1,000 or maybe 1,500 right now, because I did have just about 1,000 cocoons in this bin. But as we saw, not all of them have hatched. So I'm guessing, you know, I got somewhere between, you know, 1,250, 1,500 worms in here. All right, so I'm just moistening up the worm chow, making it a little wet, allows the worms to, you know, kind of start working on it quicker because it starts, you know, breaking down a little bit. And it also is more available. Let me just put a little bit more moisture on this. More available to the other bacteria that's in the bin to make the food available to the worms. Now, I am also going to add a little dolomite lime to this because I do have, like I said, some mites in the bin and some are fine, but I just want to keep, you know, them under control. And one way of doing that is to add dolomite lime because it helps control the pH. And mites like a more acidic environment than the worms do. And again, I'll cover more about mites and pH and all that good stuff when I do this video this weekend about them. Okay, so that's all I wanted to do on this bin. Let's quickly do the same on the, I'm covering it back up because like I said, I have the moisture level pretty much where I want it to be. Oop, it goes this way. Where I want it to be now. Damp, but not too wet. And again, it's all part of drying it down a little bit from its breeder bin's initial status. So I am slowly working my way to a point where sifting the castings out is going to be easier. Okay, so let's just do it quickly with the sister bin. This sister bin has about 2,000 cocoons in it. Again, let's just do a little, oh, here's a couple cocoons right here on the top on this one. Here's one over here. So again, cocoons will take their time. All we can do is give them the best environment we can to encourage them to hatch. But otherwise, you know, they are individuals and they're going to do what they do when they're good darn and ready to do it. Again, you can see a lot of worms in here, different maturity stages. They're all juveniles, but different maturity stages or sizes, I should say, depending on whether they hatched early in the bin life cycle or they're, you know, hatches that just happened in the last, you know, couple days. Again, I'm just aerating it briefly. Look at this. I mean, it's just gorgeous stuff, isn't it? Just beautiful. You can see, you know, these white specks, those are the mites, the white mites. There's also red mites. So, you know, you get those too. And of course I have both, but that's normal for a bin. All you want to do is just keep them, you know, under control so they don't take over and eat all your worm food, because that would be bad. You want to be feeding the worms, not the mites. Okay. Nice, nice moisture level. So let's do a quick little squeeze test so you can see it. Here's a little handful. There's a couple of worms in here. And I'm not even squeezing hard, but you can see how it's holding together, but breaking apart really easy. And you can tell just by looking at it, there's no dripping water in here. So the moisture in here is really good, and I don't want to mess with it too much. Okay, let's dig the little trench or feeding zone, whatever you want to call it. Again, I'm just putting it down towards the bottom because not having it at the surface helps keep some mites away. Also, of course, not attracting any other pests into the bin. We don't want to do that. Another raspberry. Stained paper towel. Some worm chow. I might go a little heavier on this one because I do have more worms in this bin. Good spritz of water. Now this is just regular water. I have well water, so I can use my water right out of the sink. If you have city water that is chlorinated, you'll want to let it air out a little bit so the chlorine can dissipate. That's better and healthier for your worms. And like I said, this is just plain water. Sometimes I do use molasses water, which is just a couple teaspoons of molasses that I dissolve with hot water into the bottom of a sprayer. It just comes up to here. I, you know, swish it around so the molasses dissolves, and then I fill it up with cold water, and then it's ready to use immediately in your worm bins. I do like using the molasses water, but I used up my last batch just the other day, and I haven't had a chance to, you know, make some more. Again, a nice sprinkle of the dolomite. I'm just really having trouble saying that tonight. Dolomite lime in order to help buffer the pH. I'm going to cover this back up. Okay. Put the paper back on with the plastic, and I'm good to go. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back probably in 3 to 4 days, something like that, and check on it and see how the worms are liking that worm chow and see if they need more, or perhaps they're not even eating it. We'll see, okay? And maybe I'll bring you along for that one too, because it's always nice to see how, you know, how things progress. Do they work? Do they not work? Do I have to make adjustments? That's how we learn. It's pretty much experimentation anytime you do something in your worm bins. So that's it for tonight. Thanks for joining me. I hope to catch you on the flip side. I am always yours in the dirt, Jayne.